Fairywrens are some of the cutest birds in the world. But did you know that Australia hosts 10 different species, each with their own unique look and behaviours? Hi, I'm Rob, organiser for the Birdwatch in Southeast Queensland Meetup Group. This video will be continuing our bird identification series. However, this time we're going outside our region so you can learn all about the beautiful fairywren species across Australia. You also get to hear their songs too. So whether you're travelling to Australia, you're a local and you want to see species outside your region, or you just want to learn about fairywrens, then this video is for you. Before we dive in, here's an overview of this presentation. First, I'll go through some general info on the fairywren family. Next, we'll cover how to identify each species and where to find them. After each species introduction, I'll provide various fairywren tidbits. Towards the end, I'll provide some additional identification tips. We'll then finish off with a summary and further resources. Let's get started. So why are we focusing on fairywrens? Besides the cuteness factor and their beautiful singing voices, they have fascinating social lives and play an essential role in the ecosystem. Recent studies indicate fairywren populations are declining, particularly in suburban areas. By the end of this presentation, you'll be better equipped to identify Australian fairywren species. This skill can be used to improve your birdwatching experience. And if you're interested, I'll provide details later on how you can contribute your fairywren sightings to aid research and conservation. The term fairywren is a perfect example of our confusing bird naming system. When settlers first encountered Australian birds, they used names that referred to similar looking species in Europe and the Americas. Classic wrens are such birds. They are a similar size and have a cocked tail. So originally our birds were referred to as a type of wren. It wasn't until the early 1900s that fairy was added to differentiate the two families. Wrens and fairywrens actually reside in entirely separate taxonomic families, but let's not get bogged down in the details. Australia, Papua New Guinea, and their surrounding islands are the only places in the world where you can see fairywrens in the wild. Of the 16 species worldwide, 10 of them reside in Australia. I've included a distribution map against each species so you know where to find them and arrange your travel plans accordingly. In the field, fairywrens usually forage in low shrubs and grasses. This can make it difficult for us to get a good look. However, some species regularly venture into open areas and even sing from exposed perches mid-canopy or along fence posts, so keep those binoculars and cameras ready. The fairywren diet is reasonably consistent across all species. Their main staples are insects like ants, grasshoppers, flies, moths, caterpillars, and spiders. They are great to have around the garden to keep pests under control. A smaller portion of their food intake is from seeds and berries. Fairywrens are small birds that measure approximately 14 centimeters from the bill to the tip of the tail. Size only varies slightly between species. Like in the previous videos, this slide shows how they compare in size. Starting from the right and moving left, we have the Australian magpie, followed by the pigeon, a superb fairywren in the middle, then to the left we have the bulkier house sparrow, and finally, a can of soft drink. First up, the classic. The superb is usually the first species that comes to mind when people hear the word fairywren. Superb are pretty common and more adventurous than other species. It's not uncommon to see them venturing into suburban gardens. The superb's upper half is black and has a pale blue forehead, cheeks and back. The lower half is grey. The chest to the throat is a very dark blue, but it's only noticeable in the right light. They can be found in southeast Queensland, down through New South Wales, Victoria, and around the South Australian coast. Tasmania only hosts one species of fairywren, and it's a superb. The photos and descriptions you'll see of fairywrens typically focus on the male and its breeding plumage. Fairywren identification is an intermediate birdwatching skill that requires a bit of practice. Here's why. During the breeding season, males and females don't look alike. Basically, the male needs to look colourful to, 1, attract the females, and 2, to intimidate other males. Basically saying, see this plumage? You don't want to mess with me. Females, on the other hand, are usually brown, white, or grey. This makes it easier for them to hide from predators, particularly while nesting. Males are not always in breeding plumage. Performing a molt into breeding plumage requires energy and maintenance. In addition, standing out runs the risk of being easily picked off by predators. Male fairywrens are typically in breeding plumage between 4 to 8 weeks per season. A smaller percentage of older males are able to maintain breeding plumage throughout the year, Because of this, you may hear some people refer to fairywren breeding plumage as bright plumage. You can use whatever term you feel comfortable with. The exact timing of breeding season varies depending on species and location. In general, the season occurs during the spring and summer months. So what happens outside breeding season? Well, most males cycle back to a duller appearance, looking similar to the females. During the transition period, they'll have a mixture of bright and dull plumage. This is known as eclipse or intermediate plumage. Each species is also named after how the male looks in breeding plumage, which makes sense, otherwise we'd have 10 species named something like beige rufous eye-patched fairywren and vague brown-white fairywren. And to top it all off, females and non-breeding males not only look similar within their own species, but this also holds true across most species of fairywren. For example, just say a birdwatcher spots what they believe is a female superb. Without knowing the rules, it's hard to tell whether this is actually a female or non-breeding of a red-backed, purple-backed, splendid, or other fairywren species. So what all this means is that we won't always have the male in breeding plumage to perform an ID, which makes things a bit tricky. Don't worry, although it's tricky, it's worth it to learn this skill. I'll be covering the description of female and not-so-obvious breeding plumage forms towards the end of this video. This way we can see them all side by side. Not only are fairywrens cute, they're beautiful singers too. Let's listen to the superb song now. I'll be playing the songs of the other species throughout this video. It might sound like the song from each fairywren species is almost the same, but with a bit of effort, you can learn to differentiate most of them. I've included links to each song in the show notes, should you wish to learn these at your own pace. Next up, we have the appropriately named red-backed fairywren. The male breeding plumage is all black with a red back. The amount of this red varies. Sometimes it's just a thin collar behind the neck. Other times the feathers cover the entire back, resulting in a big flash of red. They occur on the eastern side of the Great Dividing Range, starting in northern New South Wales, up through to North Queensland, wrapping around the coast of Northern Territory, and over to Broome in upper Western Australia. Before I play the red back song, do you know that birds can have different accents, just like people do? This concept applies to most birds, not just fairywrens. Birds within the same species can have different accents and dialects depending on what region they're from. If a bird from a different region is introduced, it can sometimes have difficulty communicating with others. This can also work the other way around. The foreign accent could be attractive to the opposite sex. Now let's listen to the red-backed fairywren song from Bundaberg, Queensland. And now let's listen to one from Darwin, Northern Territory. Could you notice the difference? Don't worry if you didn't. Just be aware that if you travel far from your usual region, you might be thrown off by a species making a call or song other than what you expect. The following five species look almost identical, especially from a beginner birdwatcher's perspective. Because of this similarity, they're often referred to collectively as the Chestnut-Shouldered Group. This consists of the following species: variegated, purple-back, lovely, red-winged, and blue-breasted fairywren. Appearance-wise, they're slightly smaller than a superb, and I find their blue caps are more vivid and iridescent than other fairywren species. They have a white to brown lower body, and the shoulder or upper wing is a reddish chestnut. You'll need to do further study outside this video if you want to be able to tell these species apart. Let's have a look at their distributions. First we have the red-winged, which is limited to southern Western Australia. Then we have a bit of overlap with the blue-breasted. Up in the north we have the lovely. Note with the lovely that the female is just as beautiful as the male. Lastly, we have the most widespread, which have recently been split into two separate species: the variegated fairywren, which occupies the east side of the Great Dividing Range, and the purple-backed fairywren, which occupies the rest of Australia. And here's a view of the distribution of the chestnut-shouldered group as a heat map. So no matter where you visit in Australia, you're likely to encounter at least one of the chestnut-shouldered species. The songs of the species within this group do vary, but it's difficult to tell them apart. I'm going to play the purple-backed fairywren, given it's the most widespread. Onto the white-winged fairywren. The male's an overall sea blue with white wings. It lives in the drier parts of Central Australia, from Central Queensland and South Australia, across to Western Australia. Interestingly, the subspecies that live on Dirk Hartog and Barrow Islands off the Western Australian coast sport black plumage rather than the blue that's seen on the mainland. Let's have a listen to the white wing song. Before we move on to the next species, let's cover the topic of promiscuity. All fairywren species except one are considered socially monogamous and generally hang out with the family unit. However, partners regularly sneak into other territories for a bit of extra fun, so to speak. This behavior is present in both males and females. Generally, females will sneak off during the pre-dawn hours while her social mates are asleep. She'll visit the neighboring territories and mate with any males of her choosing. She'll return before her families are wiser. The male is cocky about the whole thing. During the breeding season, he'll pluck a flower petal that contrasts with his plumage. Then he'll present it to the ladies in other territories in an attempt to impress them. This tactic is more often performed for females outside his territory. He rarely offers flower petals to his partner. Studies have shown that these promiscuous behaviours result in very few chicks that are fathered by the social male of the pair. Next up, we have the splendid fairywren. Visually, if we grab the blue markings of the superb fairywren and cover the rest of the body in vivid violet blues, we'd have the splendid fairywren. Splendid are mostly seen inland in the southern states. They're only sometimes reported towards the coast. Key areas to observe this species are close to Adelaide, in central Australia, and southern Western Australia. Here's the song of the splendid fairywren. A common trait amongst all fairywren species is that breeding pairs work with helpers to raise young and defend against predators. Helpers are usually offspring from the previous generation. Sometimes unrelated helpers may join a family, but this is usually with the long-term intention of getting an opportunity to breed with a female in the group. On to our last fairywren, the purple crowned. It's possibly the most sought after. Well, it is for me at least. The body varies from white to brown, the tail is blue, and the male has a black face mask with, of course, a purple cap. It has the most restricted range and lives around margins of rivers and creeks in the wet dry tropics of the Kimberley and Northern Territory and the Victoria River region of Western Australia. Unlike other fairywrens, purple crowns are monogamous and don't seek mates outside the pair. This is suspected because their territories are arranged side by side along the creek, so there are fewer neighbours to cheat with. Let's have a listen to the purple crown song now. If you see a brown grey fairywren, then it's going to be a female or non-breeding male. You typically require a field guide to determine the species. Rather than you needing to look back through this video, I've put all the females together here so you can see them all side by side. This might be a bit overwhelming to start with, but with practice, you'll become familiar with the species in your area. Alternatively, just look or listen for a male. So here we are, superb, splendid, white-winged. And this varies a little bit between the chestnut-shouldered group, but I'm only going to include the variegated to avoid confusion. And within this group, we have the exception, which is the lovely where the female has entirely different plumage. Next, we have the striking plumage of the purple-crowned female. And finally, we have the red-backed. So when you see a dull-coloured fairy wren in the field, pay particular attention to the overall colour, any colour markings surrounding the eyes, and the tail colour. Noting these down will improve your chances of getting a positive identification. Although we've seen them all individually, let's see the males in breeding plumage side by side. Superb, splendid, white-winged, chestnut-shouldered, in this case variegated, purple-crowned, and red-backed. When you see a colourful fairy wren on your adventures, focusing on the following will help you with identification. 1. The colour of its wings, back, and crown. 2. What type of blue is it? Is it an azure, a pale blue, or a sea blue? 3. Can you notice a distinction between the breast and the belly? For example, with the superb, we can see that the breast is dark in colour, but the belly is light. Whereas other species like red-backed, purple-crowned, white-winged, there's no distinct colour change. Now that we have all this information, how do we put it together in the field? The following will help you narrow down the species that you found. First, look out for a male in breeding plumage. This will make ID easy. If you see a beige, brown, or grey bird, follow the dull fairywren identification tips covered earlier. And of course, if you can get a photo, or you can hear the call or the song, record it on your phone. With all this information, use a field guide and focus only on fairywren species in your area. And of course, don't hesitate to ask someone if you're having trouble with identification. A perfect way to use your new fairywren identification skills is to contribute your sightings to the Fairywren Citizen Science Project. This project helps in research and conservation of fairywrens across Australia. Contributing your sightings is free and easy. Their website also contains a comprehensive resource for different plumage types for each species. Check them out on fairywrenproject.org. Okay, almost done. Let's summarise what we've gone through. Spread across Australia, we have 10 of the world's 16 fairywren species. Fairywrens are beautiful, but sometimes we need to put in a bit of effort to complete an identification. Males in breeding plumage are the easiest to ID. Females and non-breeding males look similar between species, so be sure to use the identification techniques just covered. Differentiating species songs can be tricky due to similarities between species and regional accents within the same species. Don't forget that there's a link for each song in the show notes. Fairywrens have complex social structures, including promiscuity and family helpers. That's it for Australia's Fairywrens. Let me know in the comments which one's your favourite, or whether you've had any fairywren encounters. I'd love to hear them. If you found this video helpful, give it a like, and if you'd like to see more videos like this, please subscribe. Finally, if you live or you visit in Southeast Queensland, Australia, feel free to join us for our free monthly bird walks. Wishing you fantastic fairywren bird watching, and catch you next time.